May we pray. Father in heaven, how grateful and thankful we are to be in your presence just one more time.
Thank you.
It is true.
Yeah.
And it is obvious that you are present with us today.
Thank you, God.
We could not breathe without you.
Yeah.
We could not move.
Yeah.
Without you, we have nothing. But with you, we have everything.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, sir.
Father, we've come here for the sole purpose to be revived tonight.
Yes, Lord.
We pray, oh God, that you would break up the fallow grounds of our hearts.
Yes, yes.
That you might rain righteousness upon us, that we may bear fruits of righteousness. That
yeah,
we may
yeah,
know you, we may live for you,
yes,
we may
sir,
love you
yeah,
and fulfill your will. Turn our hearts back towards you.
Yes.
We need you tonight, Father. Now, Lord, forgive me
yeah,
for any sins that I have committed. It's obvious that you're right and I'm wrong. And so, Father, grant me the grace and the mercy
yes, sir,
to declare your word.
Yes.
Touch, heal, convince, convict, convert. Do what you do best, Father. Show up and show out. When the smoke clears and the dust settles, we'll take the growth.
Yeah.
You take the glory.
I got it. Yes, sir.
In Jesus' name we pray. And let every heart say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on, put those blessings together. To be at the Sacred Ground Worship Center where none other than my friend, Pastor Jerry Dixon, is the proud pastor of
yes, sir,
this proud ecclesia called out ones.
Yeah. Right.
Thank God for his friendship over the years. And to all of the Sacred Ground ministerial staff and all those who make up the body of Sacred Ground here, we greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And then we thank you for all of God's children that are here today. And then I guess I do have to preach a little bit because the real preacher has come in. Amen. And I don't want to, you know, he's going to do better than me tomorrow. So I'm going to get on base and he's going to get me home tomorrow. Amen. It's good to be able just to get to first base, but I thank God for my friend, Pastor Richard Curry.
We thank God for him.
He is the Hank Aaron of Christianity. Amen. I'm Bobby Bonds. I'm on steroids.
Amen.
Look, we don't want to hold you long tonight. We thank God for the music ministry.
Amen.
Bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. My sunshine on a cloudy day. It's cold outside. She made it feel like the month of May.
Come on,
guess y'all know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
My girl. I'm talking about
yeah,
my girl. You get a girl and you won't be bad. Get a boy and you won't be bad. But thank you so much for fooling with me for 22 years.
Amen. Yeah. Yeah.
There is a word from the Lord tonight. This is I think this is a fresh word that I believe the Lord wants us to hear on tonight. You know, I'm not used to holding anything in my hand, so man, I'm not paying for this if I drop it. Okay? Amen. But the word of God for us tonight comes in the book of the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 1, beginning at verse 18. Amen.
All right.
Beginning at verse 18, and we're reading from the NIV. Translation on tonight. It's good to see so many of you out on tonight, Wednesday night. Thank you so much for working hard all day and then taking time out to come and be a part of this worship experience. May we stand for the reading of God's word, Matthew chapter 1, verse beginning at verse 18. These words are recorded in the NIV translation. It says, this is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph.
Yeah.
But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit.
Yes, sir.
Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law. Watch this, not to God, to the law. And yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in his mind to divorce her quietly.
That's the record.
But after he had considered this, an angel overruled the law. And the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife.
Right.
Because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.
Yes,
all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet.
All right.
The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel,
yes,
which means God's with us.
Yes, sir.
When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
Yes.
You may be seated in the presence of God. It says Joseph woke up and did immediately what the angel told him to do. Took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate the marriage until she gave birth to a son.
Yes, sir.
For a few minutes, with the help of your prayers and the aid of the Holy Spirit, I want to talk tonight about what to do when God doesn't make sense. What to do when God doesn't make sense. I've read to you several verses out of the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 1.
Robert.
These verses have a context, because anytime we read a text, we must keep the text within its context. When there's a text with no context, you can expect the con to come.
Yeah.
And so it is, my brothers and sisters, that in your spare time, in your time of devotion, in your moments of intimacy with God, I would suggest to you not just to read verses 18 through 25, but I would suggest to you to read all of chapter 1 and all of chapter 2 that make up the context of our text. For it is in chapter 1 that we see the genealogy of Jesus Christ. It is in chapter 1 that we see the birth of Christ. And then the visitors for Christ, the escape for Christ, the killing because of Christ, and the return of Christ. It's very important that you keep the text within its context. But I don't want to talk about the genealogy of Christ. I don't want to talk about the birth of Christ. I don't want to talk about the visitors of Christ. I don't want to talk about the escape of Christ. I don't want to talk about the killing of Christ, the killing of the children because of Christ. And I don't want to talk about the return of Christ. I want to look at the Father, or the earthly Father of Jesus Christ. For this text tonight is tailored to teach us that there are some times when God will ask you to do something that don't make sense. The text clearly teaches us that there's some things here that does not make sense. First of all, what does not make sense is you want me to believe and marry a woman, catch this, that's pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Wait a minute, Jesus. How in the world can she be pregnant and not pregnant by another man? Not only do you want me to marry her, but my plans for my marriage and my, watch this, and the day after I get married, which is my honeymoon, not only do you want me to marry her, but you want me to have a honeymoon with no sex. Y'all ain't talking back to me, because if there's any time that you ought to be able to sleep with a woman, it ought to be when you're married, and it's more easy to sleep with her when she's pregnant. But here it is.
Reverend.
We on Hillside. Let's talk some real stuff, because this don't make sense to me. You asking me to keep a woman that I never touched and then marry her, and then on my honeymoon don't sleep with her? to the law because the law allows me to put away her. But yet the angel came and overruled the law. Can I tell you something? There's something called the letter of the law, and there's something called the spirit of the law. And every now and then, my brothers and sisters, the spirit of the law will supersede and overrule the letter of the law. Can I help you? The wages of sin is death. The letter of the law. But the spirit of the law is the gift of God. Wait. All of us want to exact the letter of the law on people and allow God to use the spirit of the law on us.
Yeah.
But this time, the text is tailored to teach us that you're going to use the spirit of the law.
Yeah.
Just because you do it don't mean, just because you can do it don't mean God wants you to do it. So here it is. Here it is. It doesn't make sense.
Talk, man.
She's pregnant by the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And you want me to believe it.
That's good. Wow. That's good preaching.
But yet, when I woke up from the dream, I discovered that I'm going to do what you told me to do.
Yeah.
But now the very thing that you told me to do has put me in a position that we all might die.
Wow.
What happens when God has called you to do something, and somebody's out not only to take your child's life, but if you protect it, it might take your life. But not only have you called me to walk through dangerous situations, but now you're asking me to run when I've never ran before. Can I talk to some individuals who are used to fighting, who's used to standing in folks' face, who's used to confronting Negro after Negro, but this time God says, humble yourself and run.
Yeah.
And running may make you look like a chump.
You preaching.
Is there anybody in here that can testify and say, I can remember when God called me to humble myself and it looked bad to other people? It made me look weak to other people. But don't get it twisted. But then what don't make sense, the tailor, Texas Taylor, the teacher, he not only tells him to run, but he tells him to come back because the individuals who are trying to kill you is dead. But wait a minute, something strange about the text, because the individual who was trying to kill him is dead, but his son is still alive.
Talk, man.
Now you asking me to run and then come back into a situation where a family member might avenge what his father didn't take care of. It don't make sense.
Yes, sir.
The truth of the matter is, there's times when the Lord will tell us to do things that don't make sense.
Yeah.
But here's what Joseph teaches us tonight, that when God talks to us, and it does not make sense. It ain't what the Lord so much says, it's how we should respond.
Yeah.
I got some news for some individuals in here.
I see. Come on.
Your destiny is has been designed to experience victory. If you respond appropriately. Well, can I put my brakes real quick and just tell you that everybody in here has been designed to be victorious? But you just don't know it. And why is it that if God has called us and destined us to be victorious, what's keeping us from it? For the Bible says that Jesus was slain before the foundation of the world. Y'all gonna catch this in a minute. It suggests to me that before God ever created a human, he created an escape clause when a human gets in trouble. No. He didn't create you first. He created an escape route for you first because he knew you was gonna mess up. And that's good news for somebody.
get something. The longer you delay obeying, the harder it is to do.
Yes, yes, yes.
I say,
God tell you to forgive, don't do it right then.
Right then.
Because what you're doing is setting up time for the devil to get a foothold in your head. How many of us should have forgave right when the Lord told us to forgive? But let that thing fester for a night and almost like thought about killing them instead of forgiving them. Here's the text that tells you that Joseph obeyed immediately.
I see.
But then in verse 25, see, some of us know how to obey immediately. But the text says in 25 that he obeyed consistently.
I see.
Woo! How many of us always start right and never finish?
Help us.
Talk back to me, somebody. See, that's what I'm going through right now. Watch this. Soon as I walked in, my good friend who I golf with say, hey, Cersei, you look good. What you been doing? I said, I've been exercising. I said, I was at 258. I'm down to 242.
All right.
In 2 months.
All right.
But somehow I woke up with a pain in my heel, and I don't even know where it come from. Keep living. You're going to wake up with something one day, and you don't know how it got there. It just creeps in the bed with you, and the next thing you know, when you get up, you ain't moving quite right.
Yeah.
But you know what the Lord says? He says, I'm testing you see if you want to move past your 240. Woo. Y'all going to catch this in a minute. He said, because oftentimes I'll allow pain to see if you're going to push past your pain. That's my word tonight to somebody, that when you want something bad enough, you got to push past. Consistently.
Yeah.
Because he just didn't marry her, he didn't sleep with her.
Yeah.
Now that's when me and the Lord was gonna fight. Because wait a minute.
Come on.
Now I took it when you said she was pregnant by somebody else. And you made me look like a fool.
Preach it, baby.
But now
preach it.
I've been waiting all my life. Like Michael Jackson, get me a pretty young thing. Oh, y'all don't get this because she only about 16 years old.
That's right, brother.
And he ready to do the doggone thing.
That's the contrast.
Dive up it. See, that's the problem with the church. If sex is in the text and you don't want to talk about it. So you'll let the television teach you about sex. You'll let folks on the street teach you about sex.
Right.
But the Bible is teaching about sex tonight, and we're like, that's how you got here.
When
you didn't get out here on no amazing grace. How sweet the sound. Some of you got here on Luther. Some of you got here on Prince. God bless Prince Saul. You did something right. Some of y'all got here because of Prince.
Yes, I read. Come on. I see.
Here it is. When you start talking about real situations, folk want to get fake on you.
Yes, sir.
I waited a long time to get this. And now,
Lord have mercy.
You on my honeymoon?
Yeah.
She my wife?
Yes.
And she pregnant? It ain't like she can get pregnant again.
Teach her. Come on.
Well,
talk, man.
Here it is. You want me to wait? Can I tell you something, brothers? There's sometimes in life something's going to happen to our wives and you're going to have to wait.
Teach. I see.
I ain't telling you what I heard.
Come on.
Yes, sir.
Come on.
Hello. Yeah, man.
Here it is. When things don't make sense, he obeyed immediately.
Yes, sir.
He obeyed consistently.
Yeah.
What happens when you got plans and God changed?
There it is. In the middle. Yes, sir.
He says, I got plans tonight.
Yeah.
And God says,
delay.
Yeah.
Y'all gotta help me in this. Because some of y'all mad that you ain't got it right now.
Yeah.
The truth is you can't handle it right now.
Yeah.
And the Lord,
man, you preach it.
Catch that going home. Yeah. The truth of the matter is there's some things that God is delaying, not because he don't want you to have.
Yeah.
It's just that you ain't ready.
That's
and
right.
Is there anybody in here that says, I just wish I would have waited on the Lord and been patient? I wish I would have just pumped my brakes. I wish I wasn't so hot. I wish I wasn't so horny. I wish I
You preach it, man.
Hanging out with my uncle had came from Pittsburgh, God bless his soul. He said, I had just got that car. It wasn't a new car, but it was a new car to me.
Yeah.
And for some reason, I had locked the windows in the car and sat him in the car in the middle of the, watch this, in the middle of the summer.
Yeah.
Locked the windows, and I accidentally turned on the heated seats.
Oh,
he was like, hey man, it's hot in here.
Lord have mercy.
He said, can you roll the windows down? I said, oh, Uncle, I'm sorry. I forgot I locked the windows and I rolled the windows down for him. And he said, for some reason, the wind in the window ain't helping me cool off.
Yeah.
And we discovered why he couldn't.
Talk, man.
Cool off. Because he had a hot tail.
Yes.
And that's my word to some of y'all today. A window ain't going to help you. You need to stop having a hot tail.
Lord,
you need to wait on the Lord. You need to be up to courage. And he shall strengthen thy heart. Wait!
Got a hot tail, bro. Lord, have mercy.
When you look at your life, that's what you got yourself in trouble. Because we had hot tail.
Yeah,
and we trying to open up a window when we should have cut off the seat.
Yeah, I'm out of breath. Come on. Man, you preach it.
Obey consistently. But in chapter 2, verse 13 through 15, it says, obey sacrificially.
Yeah.
Because when it comes to God not making sense, the choice you make gonna cost you.
Woo.
Because salvation is free, but it ain't cheap.
Say.
Come back to me, somebody.
Say.
It's gonna cost you something. It's gonna cost you something.
Yeah.
Notice what the text says. Jesus gets his mother is pregnant, ready to deliver.
Yeah.
And the Lord says, Joseph, let go of everything that you built to this point and move.
Amen. Well done.
Wait. What happens when the Lord asks you to let go of everything you ever built your life for?
Oh, Reverend.
And asks you to leave it behind and move? Because the safest place is in Egypt and not at home.
Talk, Reverend.
Can I tell you something? You better learn how to let some stuff go in order to do what God has called you to do.
Amen.
Joseph has let go of some things that he has built his entire life. And here it is. God is asking us to let go of this guy and that woman and maybe this job and that car and this attitude and this. Because can I tell you something? Anything the Lord takes from you, he can give it back. Sacrificially means that when I begin to obey God, it's going to cause me some discomfort.
That's right, Robert.
That's what's wrong with us.
That's right.
We too comfortable.
We
need to go back to the wooden pew.
Yeah.
See?
Not the wooden pew.
But something, somebody said, it made us stand more than it made us sit. There's some things we need because we don't know how to handle comfort because we get too comfortable.
Yeah.
Ain't that what's wrong with our relationships?
Talk right.
Folks that got too comfortable with you and think it don't take to keep you what it took to got you.
Come on. Yeah.
I know I didn't say it right, but you heard it.
Yeah.
I use good English and karma, but down here, it's broken vernacular.
Yeah.
Here it is. Folk have gotten too complacent and too comfortable. And here the Lord tells Joseph that not only do you got to obey immediately, and not only you got to obey consistently, but you got to obey sacrificially.
I see.
It's going to cost you.
Yeah.
Let it go, Joseph, and move your child.
Yeah.
But if you really read the real text, Joseph was given something to sustain him in Egypt while he lost everything at home. Because when the Magi's came.
Yes, sir.
All right.
What did Jesus need frankincense, myrrh, and gold for? Yeah, y'all read y'all Bibles a little bit. Because they were worshiping to the Lord, but Mary and Joseph was using it. And that's my word to you today. That when you ride with Jesus, whatever you need, come with it. You are not tripped when you ride on Jesus, go tell. Because God's got everything we need. He's got peace. He's got joy. Is anybody in here said that peace and joy is worth more money than I could ever?
Amen.
For the last thing I see, it don't make sense that how should we respond? Obey immediately.
Yeah.
Obey consistently.
Yes, sir.
Obey sacrificially.
Talk, Reverend.
But obey courageously.
Amen.
Oh, my God.
Teach.
Can I tell you something? You're going to have to learn how to go to Egypt and get strong and come back and face your fears.
That's right.
Amen.
That's
right.
Come in.
Yes.
God ain't never meant for us to run too long.
Yeah.
He only meant for us to run long enough till we can get strong and
come
back.
Yeah.
Is there anybody in here saying that, guess what, I might run for a minute, but I ain't running to run away. I'm running to get strong. And when I get strong, I'm coming back. But can I tell you what sent Joseph back? A word.
Yeah.
Don't I miss it?
Yeah, a word.
A word from an angel.
Yeah.
Not from the law.
Talk, man.
Okay, wait. See, it's a shame to have information with no inspirational revelation.
Yeah.
That's right.
I'm saying so many of
y'all don't know. Yeah, you said it.
Because there's a whole lot of us got information.
Yeah.
But you ain't got no inspiration and you ain't got no revelation.
Yeah.
And can I tell you something? Information with no inspiration and no revelation will lead you into a dark place.
Yeah. Talk, man.
The law was leading him in the wrong way.
Yeah.
Inspiration and revelation turned him the right way.
Oh, yeah, man. Yeah.
Dr. E.V. Hill, who lived in Los Angeles, California, who ran one of the greatest food pantries that this world could ever have, was the first person to graduate from college in his family.
Yeah.
And his grandmother could not read. And his grandmother would make him sit down and read him the Bible.
Yeah.
E.D. Hill said he didn't like reading the Bible to her because he could never get two scriptures out without her saying stop.
Yeah.
And he asked him, why would she make you stop? E.D. said, I'm the one that went to school. I had the education. But his grandmother used to say, stop, baby. Now, let me tell you what that means.
Yeah.
I talked to some people in here. You may have education, but you need some revelation and some inspiration. And can I tell you something? Every now and then, God sends an angel around you to tell you, go left, don't go right. Sit down and shut up. Get up and speak. And you got to learn how to listen to the Lord and not the law.
Amen.
I got to go. Thank you, brother. I thought I wasn't going to get back here, but this place brings back memories to me.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I love coming to sacred ground because almost 22 years ago, this is where me and my baby had our first dance. Because this is where we had our what? Reception after our wedding.
Mama,
I remember. I remember. This floor was still
Yes.
Jeffrey Johnson Jr., if he was here, he's a grown man now.
Yeah.
But when he was in the kindergarten, his class went to the radio station.
Yeah.
And he was telling them that I know God black. And when we go to the radio station, I ain't riding back on the bus.
Yeah.
I'm riding back with God black.
Yeah.
And the kids thought he was lying. Little Jeff went down there, God black came, and all the kids said he ain't lying. All the kids got on the bus, and little Jeff walked off with God black. And God black said, hey man, where you live at? He said, I don't know. He said, what's the address? He said, I don't know. He said, man, what's your father's telephone number? He said, you should have it. You his friend. I ain't got it. He said, well, how am I supposed to get you home? He says, I don't know how you gonna get me home. He says, but if you could just get me to the church, I know my way back home.
Oh, brother.
No, he says, but how am I supposed to get you back to the church? He said, on the church is a steeple.
Yeah.
And on the steeple is a cross.
My yeah. God.
If you can just get me to the cross,
yeah.
I can get my way back home.
Oh, man,
good night, my brothers and sisters. And may the Lord bless you real good. But how many know if you can just get me to the cross,
yeah.
I can get back home.
Get home.
At the cross, at the cross.
Yeah.
Where I first saw the light.
Oh,
and the burdens of my heart
yeah.
rolled away.
Yeah.
It was there
yeah.
by faith.
Yes.
I received my sight.
Yeah.
Always go back to where it started from.
Yes, Lord.
It started with Christ and it ends with Christ.
Yes.
I pray for revival upon your people
yes.
tonight.
Yes.
I pray, oh God, that their hearts would become sensitive
yes.
to the messengers of God.
Mm.
I pray that this wouldn't just be any old sermon,
mm.
but it would be one that causes us to reflect. One that causes us to remember and one that causes us to remain and move closer to you.
Yes.
I thank you, Lord. Bless you, Lord.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.